Please give a very, very warm welcome to Charlie Billingham. And we are, of course, spending many hours here looking at your work. At least I am here with the speakers. You have to turn around, for those of you who haven't seen it. I wanted to begin with the beginning and ask you, Charlie, how it all began, how you came to art, or how art came to you, if there was an epiphany.
I've always loved art since I was very young. And the kind of paintings, I suppose, that I'm beginning to be associated with come from these prints and drawings, which I also have been really interested in since I was very young. My parents used to have a set of these Cruikshank prints, which we had in the house, and I would always be very fascinated by them when I was a child. And it was really from that that I started to look into this period of drawing and printing.
Now, it's interesting because this exhibition has, of course, a lot to do with, you know, fragmented aesthetics, the idea of collage also, and archaeology. And you've used a lot of images from the Regency era. You draw images from caricature, from caricatures, you know, created around the really the end of the 18th century. And I was very curious, you know, if you could explain a little bit what inspires you about these late 18th century illustrations, because you said in a previous conversation that, you know, it's interesting if we look again at the work which is behind you, that you were interested in the fluidity of the lines. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, there's something really interesting that happens in the late 18th century and early 19th century with these caricaturists, which is, it sort of starts with Hogarth, I suppose, in the mid 18th century. And then by the kind of early to mid 19th century, it fizzles out, and there's this fluidity of line, a kind of flamboyance in style, which really appeals to me. And it seems to get lost in maybe the 1830s. It's at a moment, I suppose, when the Industrial Revolution is taking over. I don't know if that's a reason that this happens, but there's this moment of in caricature around this time which really appeals. That's it's fun, and it's sometimes kind of slippery and it lacks the kind of tightness that comes in the Victorian era.
And it's interesting because, of course, you know, I can't, ever since I know your work, I was actually thinking about that. And again, today, when I saw the work here, it came to my mind, which is because, of course, this period from which these illustrations are, these, you know, satirical Regency era illustrations, was, you know, a period marked by very important social and political, and also, last but not least, economic changes, mm-hmm. shifts, and it marks this quite brutal transition, no, from the Industrial Revolution, you know, modern capitalism. Basically, it marks a transition, you know, it marks the beginning of Industrial Revolution in a way. It's a transition into, one can say, it's a transition into modern capitalism. And I was kind of wondering, because, I mean, we're also living a very, I mean, something Edouard Glissant said, that it's, we're living a similarly violent moment. You know, it's not the first time we're experiencing globalization, but it's a very, fueled by technology, you know, we're living an extremely violent moment of transition. So I kind of wonder if you see correspondences, or if you want us to see correspondences.
It's certainly not, it wasn't my ambition to create parallels in that way. I think a lot of people see the work and think that that's what I'm aiming to do. But I mean, I'm interested in hearing people talk about that parallel, but it's not something which I feel like I'm an expert in.
Yeah. So it's something which is up to the viewer.
Yeah.
To kind of read it or not. But what's clearly here visible, and again, when you turn around and look at the wall, you see cropping, you see zooming, you see fragmenting of the imagery. So you extract fragments, from these original, illustrations, and then present the work in a rather domestic environment, often like here, using wallpaper. So you clearly recontextualize these found images. Can you tell us a little bit about the process? So you told us already you grew up with these things in your parents' home. Mm-hmm. You then started to collect them. You go to a specific place in London, I think, where you find them.
Yes, and I studied in a school in London called the Royal Academy Schools.
Yeah.
And it's actually where two of the main artists that I look at studied there in the 18th century.
Cool.
So that's James Gilray and Thomas Rowlandson. And they would make and sell their prints in very much in the area where the school is in London. So I started to really explore more, build up a kind of a resource of imagery and books, and now I've started to collect the prints as well themselves, and find sections that interest me. Yeah. So I have a kind of an archive of books and a digital archive of things to draw from. As you say, yeah, fragments and sections, yeah. And I've started to also collage them together. So now it's not just taking the sections themselves, but also put them together with other things to create my own compositions and build something new, but trying to retain a sense of something distinctive that these prints and drawings have.
Now you mentioned already the digital, and I want, like with all the previous conversations, again, ask you about the digital, because you are part of this generation who has grown up with digital media. You grew up in the 80s, 90s. How in this process of what we see here, what kind of role does the digital play? Because obviously it starts from very, very analog sources, and it's interesting also that you actually very often collect the actual prints. You have them as physical, prints, but then in terms of the cropping, the fragmenting, where does the digital enter? What role does the digital play?
I think for me, it's I use digital technology as a tool, yeah. And it's not something which I really think about a lot in terms of intellectually, really. I'm usually the last to come to social media and technology. I didn't really have a computer until I was in my early 20s, which most of my peers were very much more literate than I was. And the same with a mobile phone. And
so you only had that in the 2000s?
Yeah. So, I'm not really a good person to talk to about digital.
But it's a tool you use. Your first exhibition, when that's how I heard about your work for the first time, because, coming from a German-speaking background, I was fascinated that you did an exhibition called Schaulust. Can you tell us about Schaulust? What is Schaulust and what was that show?
Well, it was about a love of looking. And so I was finding images, fragments of images of people staring into spaces. In the original images, they were often not staring into space, but I was creating this illusion by cropping them out of their original source and having them staring into either a kind of monochromatic space or abstract spaces. So it was really about a sort of celebration of looking and the love of looking and how that can relate to painting and the intimacy between the viewer and the painting.
Which is why it's so wonderful that we can actually really look at your work here for so many hours. Now, one thing which I was curious also is, in 1908, Walter Sickert said, and it's something you quoted, taste is the death of a painter.
Mm.
And you say that you don't agree with this.
No.
Yeah, so I'd like to hear why.
I'd forgotten I'd said that.
No, you said because taste is complex. I want to hear about that, you know, that this sort of quality which art has. And
I feel like taste is really integral as a painter, and there's something very pretentious about shunning taste or thinking that painting is more important than taste or a celebration of an interior or a garment or fashion. I think taste is something to be celebrated.
And what about the place where you work? Because often the work, you know, replicates this interior. So I read there is a studio, but there is also a study. It's kind of separate rooms. Can you tell us about?
Yeah, so I wanted to build a space where I could start to archive the books that I collect and the prints, so I have planchettes to keep them in. Also, I mean, it's to keep things clean as well, because it's messy to make paintings. And it's also somewhere to test out building an interior. So I have walls in the studio where I test these prints. So the prints that you see on the wall, it looks like a wallpaper, but it's actually a print directly onto the wall. So it's like a woodblock print. But I use foam because it's softer on the wall. But it's the same kind of process as making a woodblock print. So I test that out at the studio and create these kind of interiors and installations in the studio to try things out.
I used to work, you know, in 99 for a year at the Sir John Soane's Museum. And that was a great experience. I don't know, who has ever been to the Sir John Soane's Museum of you in London? No one, only very few people have been to the Sir John Soane's Museum. Extraordinary, you have been, right?
Yeah,
a 19th century museum on Lincoln Inn Fields of the architect Sir John Soane's. It's a kind of a Gesamtkunstwerk, a total work of art. And, you know, he was friends with Hogarth. And so when I lived there, because I curated an exhibition, and they had a guest room there for Soane's Color, so they gave me the guest room for a year. So, you know, it was very weird to live in this house, very spooky with the Egyptian mummy and, you know, and very dark at night and strange, almost sort of, scary, full of ghosts, very ghostly, ghostly environment. And so, you know, looking at Hogarth every day, I was kind of interested in seeing actually that, you know, something you describe about these fluid lines, you know, is already there in Hogarth, in his work. But then it really becomes strong in the people you are inspired by, and they are kind of much less known than, you know, Hogarth. Particularly, you mentioned Gilroy before. Mm. And, you know, in the sense of that, I think very few people here know who this is. I think it would be good to hear a little bit more who Gilroy is and the kind of grotesque quality it also has, which you're interested in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah, James Gilroy is an artist who I look at a lot, and as well as Thomas Rowlandson. Yeah. And they were both born in the same year, in 1757. So they really, I guess, they both became the kind of big caricaturists of that era, which is, I suppose, like one generation after Hogarth. I've seen a lot of Gilroy's prints, but I don't know a huge amount about his life. I know that Rowlandson was a big gambler and drinker and bon vivant, but I don't know a huge amount about Gilroy. I think a lot of his biography is disputed, and so I'm not really a specialist on that so much as the prints, I suppose.
What is your unrealized project? Can you tell us about something you have not done yet, you're going to do?
For a long time, I really wanted to write a ballet, but this is something I haven't actually really been thinking about recently. I just want to be making paintings, really. I've got a lot of ideas for new paintings, and that's really what I love doing most.
And are you connected to other painters? Are you part of a group or a community?
Yeah, absolutely. My girlfriend runs a gallery in London, and so I meet a lot of painters through her. Yeah. She shows a lot of painting. And where my studio is, there's also a lot of other painters and artists. My neighbor is an artist called Than Hussein Clark, who makes mostly sculpture and
design
and performance. Yeah. And we talk a lot about art together. He sometimes makes paintings now as well.
And sculpture, yeah.
Yeah.
Last question, Europe. At the moment of the Brexit.
Yes.
What is your view on Europe?
I think I feel very anxious and quite sad about the situation at the moment. I still feel like nobody really knows what's going to happen. I feel hopeful that perhaps the United Kingdom will remain in Europe. I feel like that would be a very positive outcome, but I don't know if I'm being overly optimistic. When I was planning this show, I was always assuming that the day that the show opened was really the day we were meant to be leaving the Union. And it's nice to be here now and feel that it hasn't happened yet. So, I feel hopeful but a bit worried.
Thank you so much, Charlie. A big round of applause for Charlie Whittingham. Thank you.